If you've ever been interested in connecting an external graphics card, most of you probably know about the issues they have related to the bandwidth limit, up to 40 gigabits per second. We've heard this phrase a lot, but I was wondering what bandwidth limitation actually is and how exactly does it affect GPU performance? Is it in the number of frames it can send to the monitor? Maybe the limitation relates to the number of teraflops processed. Does the performance also depend on USB devices connected to the eGPU, as some of you mentioned in the comments? I've read a lot of articles and documentation, did a lot of benchmarks, and even contacted Thunderbolt directly for some clarification. So now, I'm ready to answer those questions. And to ensure that the technical side of the test is accurate as possible, I'll connect a top-tier graphics card to a quite powerful laptop. This time I bought a new Gigabyte Aero. It comes equipped with one of the latest Intel CPUs, 13700H, which has 14 cores, 20 threads and 16 GB of DDR5 memory, and even a discrete RTX 4050. It has a stylish design without overwhelming RGB lighting, it's slim and lightweight, and it's packed into a compact chassis with a stunning 14-inch OLED display at 90Hz refresh rate. And most importantly, it has a Thunderbolt 4 port, which we need for our eGPU. If you're interested in which eGPU enclosure I'll be using, how it works and how to set it up, I have already made a video about it, and you can find it in the suggested videos. While I set up everything, it's essential to understand the theory. Theoretical cable bandwidth is up to 40 gigabits per second, but when connecting PCIe devices, such as eGPU, it's allocated to 4 PCIe lines 3.0, or in other words, 32 gigabits per second. Despite having the same bandwidth between the Thunderbolt 3 and 4 versions, Thunderbolt 3 has lower minimum PCIe data requirements. This means it can operate at speeds from 16 to 32 gigabits per second, and every eGPU enclosure based on Thunderbolt 3. If you are curious about USB 4 bandwidth speed, it uses Thunderbolt 3 standards. After all, the cable version is not the only factor that determines speed. Another factor is the Thunderbolt controllers that are included in every device. This controller is responsible for the feature set that will be available on your device. For example, I found out that my laptop's Thunderbolt doesn't support charging, so I always had to connect an additional cable for it. As far as I understood, existing eGPU controllers are capable of delivering 22-24 gigabits per second of bandwidth, according to AIDA GPU benchmark, and the remaining bandwidth is probably for the reverse video signal in case of using the built-in monitor of the laptop and the USB devices. So what is this bandwidth used for? To explain this, let's take a simplified look at how frames are generated for games. CPU calculates the logic, creates object geometry, and sends instruction to the graphics card through the PCIe lines, which have a varying bandwidth depending on the version. Meanwhile, the GPU takes data from the CPU and performs graphics-related calculations. This includes rendering 3D objects, applying shaders, calculating lighting and effects. Afterwards, it creates a frame that sends to the monitor. Therefore, if CPU generates instructions for 100 frames per second and the GPU can handle only 70, GPU becomes a bottleneck and you'll see only 70 frames per second, and vice versa. In case of eGPU, everything works similarly, but instead of PCIe lines, we have a Thunderbolt connection, which may not have enough bandwidth to transfer CPU instructions to the GPU. Therefore, if we use the laptop's built-in monitor, the finished frames need to be sent back and use already limited bandwidth and impact performance even more. With the theory covered, it's time to move on to the tests. We'll be using an RTX 4090, and I am interested to see the percentage of its utilization, so all tests will be done in 4K to push GPU to the limits. I also want to find out what a combination of a powerful laptop with a high-end GPU is capable of. It is important to note that you shouldn't focus only on the percentage of GPU utilization on the chart. It looks inaccurate. When RTX 4090 is running at 90% of utilization, it cannot consume only 200 watts and deliver such low frame rate, since it typically consumes around 420 watts under full load, occasionally going up to 450 watts. So, in games where power consumption rises above 300 watts, we can see an excellent performance, and we should pay more attention to this indicator. If it's at 200 watts, it means that the graphics card is roughly loaded at about 50%. I've noticed a tendency where games that are more CPU demanding tend to put a minimal load on the GPU. This might be due to the large number of instructions the CPU can't send to the graphics card quickly enough due to the limited bandwidth. The battlefield had a lot of stuttering, and I'm sure it's not a CPU bottleneck, as the gameplay was even more stable on a discrete RTX 4050. At the same time, games like Rocket League can deliver over 600 frames on minimum settings and over 300 on max settings. In Deathloop, FPS varies from 50 to 100, depending on where you look at, and this is unusual behavior for this game. And Days Gone showed the best results so far. God of War also performed well, but there was likely a CPU bottleneck, as FPS didn't change much with changing DLSS from ultra performance to disabling it completely. And every other game that I've tested has shown no problems, only insufficient GPU utilization. Regarding the USB connection. In my first eGPU video, I connected an SSD with games to the eGPU, so I wouldn't have to store them on the laptop storage. This way, you connect one cable and you have both the graphics card and your game library. But few people wrote to me that this negatively affects bandwidth. This seemed unlikely, because SSDs are barely stressed during gaming. But I tested it by running a game from an external SSD connected to the eGPU and from the laptop's internal storage. And there was no difference at all. To make this test even more complex, I started copying files from the SSD to the laptop. And even that didn't affect performance. But why? It's likely because part of the bandwidth is reserved for this on the Thunderbolt controller of the eGPU, so you can use SSDs this way. Also, I tried to connect VR headset directly to the eGPU and it worked with no issues at all. After all these tests, I came to the conclusion that there is no recommended GPU as an external graphics card. I often heard the phrase that there is no point in buying anything more powerful than RTX 3060. And perhaps in the past that was the case. Maybe it was assumed with a laptop having, let's say, 4 cores, 8 threads, so your CPU will be a bottleneck. But times are changing. My laptop now has 14 cores, 20 threads, can work at 5 GHz, and it's more than capable of working with serious graphics cards. As demonstrated in case of Days Gone, we can see an excellent result that an RTX 3060 couldn't come close to achieving. For instance, here are results with a built-in RTX 4050. But anyway, we shouldn't forget about examples where high-end GPU performed poorly in CPU-demanding games. But I'm not sure if this will be a problem for those who just want to use opportunity to play on their older laptops with budget graphics cards. In this scenario, even if there is no bandwidth issue, the FPS wouldn't go any higher, so I wouldn't bury the idea of eGPU. Why not just buy a gaming laptop? Well, then it won't be as light and portable. They can be noisy under load, and they are expensive. This laptop cannot be called cheap either, and I really wanted to keep it instead of my PC. However, this laptop makes noise even when you use a browser, and to avoid that, I had to change power settings to power saver every time manually. After using a MacBook, which works most of the time without the fans, it's hard for me to accept this. Moreover, it was behaving unstable. After my laptop went to sleep or was restarted, I had to reconnect the cable from the eGPU or external SSD every time, and the lack of the ability to charge the laptop via Thunderbolt cable. This created a terrible user experience to me. Although it was perfect on paper, but I returned it to the store. I didn't face such issues with the Thunderbolt connection on my Lenovo Office laptop, maybe because of a better Thunderbolt controller. I don't know. By the way, the first devices with Thunderbolt 5 will be releasing soon, which looks promising. I'll wait for a more power efficient laptop with Thunderbolt 5 and proper cooling. For now, I'll go back to my desktop PC that has a Thunderbolt port. Guess what I want to test now?